this morning. It's great that we weren't here an hour early because it's the only time, as I said, that we can turn back time. Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, everybody didn't think I was funny now because I told them before. No, it's not funny now. However, it's great to be in the presence of the Lord. It's great to be in the house of the Lord, isn't it? And as we come into autumn, don't we see the beauty out there of the Lord? And you know, all the trees, as I drove up the valleys yesterday, you could see all the gold trees, all the red trees, all mixed in. You know, it is beautiful. Walk down to Pontypool Park or just take a walk in the park and just see God's creation, His beauty. Isn't it great? Isn't it great? And you know, it should give us that little bit of spring. It won't be a spring that's in spring because we're now in winter. But let's praise the Lord today for what He's done. And let's give thanks to the Lord for His goodness. For it says, doesn't it, in Psalm 136, it says, oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. He is good. Praise the name of the Lord, it says. Praise Him, all you servants of the Lord. Amen. You who stand in the house of the Lord, in the courts of the house of our God, praise the Lord, for the Lord is good. And again, it says this about singing, doesn't it? It says, sing praises to His name, for He is pleasant. As we sing today, we're not singing just for the sake of singing. We are singing and praising God in the highest. He is present. He is aware of our singing. He is aware of our presence, of His presence. We should be aware of His presence as we are singing to the Lord. So we go sing and to just sing for and praise the Lord, for He is good. Thank you.
Join together this morning and we'll praise and worship.
Your endless
put your loving arms around them, that they would just know you and just feel your presence this morning. I thank you, Father, that we are able to come around your word in freedom to listen to your word preached. And that's a privilege that we might not always recognize, but we pray for those that where it's not so safe, where there's persecution, Lord, and that you would just protect them where they might be this morning. We praise you and we just lift you up in your wonderful name, Jesus. Amen.
Well, you know what? It's that time of year, isn't it? The shops are getting busier. We've seen a lot of Christmas stuff. And that brings me in to our toy appeal and food appeal for Christmas. Do you know what? Somebody knocked the door last night with it. We've had their first donation of toys. They knocked the door and said, Wayne, I got some toys for Lighthouse. Do take them on. They're only a start. I've got some more in my office. Isn't that good? Isn't that good? So we'll be running the Christmas appeal from the end of October, so November into December. And every one of those, all food, will be given locally. Will be given locally. So, you know, just, you know, I love it when that comes on because we know it's nearer. Christmas is on, is nearer, yeah? So let's be aware of that, you know, it's joyful when people knock your door with donations, yeah? And they don't want, I said, do you want me to say where they come from? He said, no, I don't want you to say where they come from. I just want the children and the people in this community to receive something I didn't receive when I was younger. Isn't that great? Isn't that great? That's love, isn't it? That's love. And did you know that some people think the greatest evidence of God's presence is working the power? Some people think the greatest evidence of God's presence or work is popularity. And some people think the greatest evidence of God's presence or work is passionate feelings. But the greatest evidence of God's presence and work is love. Is love. Yeah, where God is present and working, guess what? There will be love. Wherever he is present and working, there will be love. And we're going to speak about love this morning. So if you've got your Bibles with you, come with me to 1 John 4:7-12. 1 John 4:7-12. And it's taken from the Amplified version. But it's very similar to whatever version you have. And it says this. Behold, let us unselfishly love and seek the best for one another. For love is from God. And everyone who loves others is born of God and knows God through personal experience. The one who does not love, the one who does not love has not been acquainted with God, does not and never did know him. For love, God is love. He is the originator of love. And it is an enduring attribute to his nature. By this, the love of God was displayed in us. In that God has sent his one and only begotten Son. The one who is truly unique. The one who of his kind into the world. So we might live through him. In this love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation that is of the anointing sacrifice and the sacrificing offering of our sins, fulfilling God's requirement for justice against sin and placing its wrath. Beloved, if God so loved us, in this incredible way, we also ought to love one another. No one has seen God at any time, but if we love one another with unselfish concern, God abides in us. And his love, the love that is in his essence, abides in us, is completed and perfected in us. Wow, what verses they are. What verses are that? So let me explain first. I'm going to say that the central of love in the Christian faith, you know, love in the Christian faith is central all the way through it. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. But even before that, if we look at creation, God is love. Yeah? If we look through the Old Testament up to the New, we will see this love transformed right away through the Bible. We see John's teaching reveals why love is essential in a believer's life. Can I just say that? John's teaching reveals why love is essential in a believer's life. Love is a litmus test of the authentic relationship with God. If we are indeed God, children of God, through faith in Jesus Christ, we share in his nature. For it says in 2 Peter 14, in verse 3, Peter reveals that through knowing God, Christians have been given everything we need to live the life God calls us to be. Peter reveals, yes, I am repeating that, that through knowing God, Christians, that's those who believe God, believe in God, yeah, that's those who have given their life, you know, as Jesus asks us to do and follow his teachings. Christians have been given everything we need to lead the life God has called us to do. Wow. Wow. We need to lead the life God calls us to do. God's nature is love. Therefore, we will exhibit love. Demonstrating Christian love confirms the reality of our spiritual life. I know, you know, that is something we need to get hold of. Demonstrating Christian love confirms the reality of our spiritual life. See, he's the originator of love, and it's an enduring attribute of his nature. See, love is the defining characteristics of God and shows how we are called to reflect his love in our lives. And that's hard, isn't it? Reflecting his love in our lives. It's a very difficult thing to do. But all genuine love originates from God. It's not just an emotion, but it's a divine attribute. So what's this divine attribute of love? Well, there's many ways, isn't it? We see that in the Bible. There's many things. But the one I'm talking about today is the agape. The agape. That is the love that God gave us. That's the love God gives us. The agape. Or agape. So let's go back to these verses. No one has ever seen God, but if we love, and it's agape, one another, God lives in us, and his love, agape, is made complete in us. Because God is love, agape. And whoever lives in love, which is agape, lives in God and God in him. Strong verses, these are. See, agapitos, did you know, is only used of Christians as united with God or each other in love. So you, John, is stressing believers, as I've said, with a tender word of exhortation, even as he ensures them as his own love for them. It's easy to call someone a tender name. You know, it's easy to call someone a tender name. It's easy to, you know, with our mouths. But it's not so easy to match our lips. It's not so easy to match our lips, is it? Yeah? His behavior was in harmony of his word. Can we say the same? Can we say the same this morning? Someone wrote this: faith is a flower that receives the dew and the sun, while love is a flower that reflects beauty and fragrance. That was quoted by W. Griffin Thomas. He's anonymous, but see, faith only. I just take in belief. Our faith, we take in belief. I don't give up love, beauty, fragrance. Perhaps. No love, no fragrance or beauty. Love only, I just give out love. I don't take in faith, belief, reading, studying the word. No faith, no dew of sunshine. Flowers don't grow in caves. That's what he said. It's true, isn't it? Unless you've got a flower that doesn't like the sun or light, they don't grow in caves. So faith and love, what I'm telling you, must go together. This is what he's saying here. It must go together. Agape love is not just an emotional feeling or affection like filio. That's brotherly love. Agape is the gold standard. Yeah? It's a highest bar. Yeah? And I know that is the most difficult. But that's what Jesus and that's what God gave us. And he says that's the way we are to love. That's the way we are to love. Instead, it's an active choice to love others. It's not emotional. That's what he's saying here. It's an active choice that we love others. Even when it requires personal sacrifices. You know, and sometimes agape love will give us personal sacrifices, will mean that. But this is the kind of love that God demonstrates for us, as I've said, by sending his son to die on the cross. It's the gold standard in 1 John 4:7-12. John emphasizes that God's agape love is the source of all true love. Isn't that amazing? It's the love of all true love. Verse 10 says this, for example: in this is love, not that we are loved by God, but he loved us and sent his son as the atoning sacrifice for our sins. We couldn't do it ourselves. You know, many tried to obtain the gold standard. We see that in the Old Testament. And they failed. And it wasn't until Jesus came down, or God came down. God came down. And Jesus was born, that he gave his life as a living sacrifice. For you and me. For you and me. That is agape love. I'm not saying you've got to do that for anyone today. I'm not saying you've got to give your life up for people. But what I am saying, we've got to be aware of the love that we need to show to others. Yeah? He loved us and sent his son. This kind of love is transformation. Or transformative, I may add. Sorry about that. John calls believers to love one another with the same agape love that God's shown to us. It's not based on whether someone is deserving. Do you know what? It's easy to love somebody who deserves love, isn't it? That's easy, isn't it? You know, if somebody's done something nice, oh, I love that person. Yeah? But what about the love to others who are undeserving? That is the crux of it, isn't it? And that's the crux that I'm talking about today. That's the crux of it I'm talking about today. And it's difficult. It's not easy. The concept of agape is God's love is self-sacrificing. It's when we sacrifice. Yeah? Highlighting a gap in love is seen in Jesus' sacrifice for us. And I know I keep saying that today. And you might say, you keep saying that. But it's so true. It's so true. And I want us to get that today. John 3:16, to reinforce that God's love is about giving, even when it costs everything. God's love is about giving, even when it costs everything. God's love is demonstrated through the Son, Jesus Christ. You're saying, Pastor, but you've said that once. You've said that twice. You've said that three times. But it's so true. And I want us to get hold of it today, as I've already said. Jesus' love and sacrifice are the ultimate revelation of divine love. Offered so we may, guess what, have love through him. We may have love through him. See, our call to love like God. You say, well, I'll never attain to that. I'll never get to that gold standard. Well, our call to love like God, let me encourage you. This love is not something we receive, but something we are called to give. We are to extend agape love to others in the church, our families, and the world, even when it's hard. And it is hard. See, God, you know, I've said that. He loved us and sent his Son for our sins. In this, the love of God was manifested towards us that God sent his begotten Son. This shows us what it means. You know, love is not redefined by the sacrifice of Jesus, as stated in 1 John 3:16. It's often defined by the giving Father. It was a sacrifice from the Father to send the second person, or himself, of the Trinity, and a sacrifice to pour out the judgment we deserved. What I suppose I'm saying in the church is we are to love each other with the agape love. Yeah? Not the filial love, just the filial love. That's a different love. Agape love is the highest standard, is the gold standard. And I've said that. And I'll keep saying that. You know? The cross is the clearest picture of love. We are loved deeply by God, not because of what we have done, but because, guess what? You're going to say, because what he has done. Yes? So if God loved us in this incredible sacrificial way, guess what? We must love others in the same manner. Because Jesus said, you love as I love. You love as I love. So if he loved us with the highest of love, the agape love, he means that we should love with the agape love. And that blows my mind, because I think, but that's difficult, God. That is really difficult to obtain. And God says, well, yes. But that's what you should be, that's what we should be, how can I put it? Working towards. Working towards. See, if God loves us that way, we see it in 11 and 12 of what I was saying today. Verse 12 says this, no one has seen God, but when we love others, God's presence is made manifest through us, and his love is perfected in us. So how does we go, because this is what I'm saying, how do we go and get this seeming impossibility? Well, I'm saying it's not instant. It's not like going to McDonald's and asking for a burger. You know, we get that instantly. Agape love is working. It's not getting it instantly.
We can't just turn it on and off. We need the Holy Spirit working in us. It's part of the Holy Spirit. We can't agape love without the Holy Spirit within us. Christians do not mean expecting perfection from everyone at all times. You know, we will only love you, you know, if my parking space outside my house is left clear. It is annoying, by the way. I don't know anybody who don't suffer from that with all the cars on the road. But it's not being annoyed with people, but it's loving people. As Jesus loved us. It's self-giving heart, which is challenging. Her heart is challenging, but achievable through the transformation of the Holy Spirit. I've just said that. I'm not following my notes, sorry. But instead of aiming for the unattainable ideal, you might inspire others by highlighting progress. And growth and grace on this journey of love. We've got to be graceful with people. Yeah? Why? And you go tell me why now, aren't you? No? We've got to be graceful with people because God is graceful with us. Yeah? He's been graceful with us. The message of agape becomes both aspirational and accessible, helping others to understand and embroider it within our means. I'm going to finish with this today. It's not a long one today, but do anybody know about the South American fish called Four Eyes? Have anybody heard about the South American fish called Four Eyes? Would you like to hear about it? Yeah? Would you like to hear about him? Well, I'm going to tell you a story. It's about a South American fish called Four Eyes. See, this fish knows how to make the best of two worlds. His secret is his large, bulging eyes. He's got large, bulging eyes. The creator designed them so that he can see above the water and below the water. Isn't that cool? He can see with his bulging eyes above the water and below the water. With the upper half of his eyes above the surface and the lower part of his eyes below the surface. The top half have an hairline lens, what they call. And the bottom half have a water lens. So he's not only got bulging eyes, he's got the bottom half, which is waterproofed, and the top half is not waterproofed. One for here, for the light, and one down below. But together, the two lenses outfits Four Eyes. That's why it's called the bulging Four Eyes. He's got a natural bifocals like mine. Well, not like mine, but you know what I mean. I can see through the top, and when I'm reading, I can see through the bottom. Just imagine this fish doing the same. Not reading a book, all right? Not reading, but looking through the top and bottom. Allowing him to see the upper world and the underworld in a sense. See, we need to be like this little tropical fish. Why do we need to be like this tropical fish? We should look up longingly to the idealism of heaven. So we look up to heaven while looking down lovingly to the realistic of the earth. We live on the earth. The end we look is to reflect a hunger and thirst for the truth and the righteousness
while the earthly look shows our compassion and our love for the lost and suffering. So we need to be like this South American fish. Perhaps we, you know, you've been called four eyes before, but for a wrong reason. Who is in a better position to know of the best of both worlds than Christians? See, we have received both truth and love. Both truth and love. Others said, it's only a short one today. I just want to get across that we need, church need, to be operating in the gap area. It's not easy. Yeah? It's when we don't feel, perhaps when we don't feel like operating in that love. You know, when you get up grumpy, not today, because we all had extra hours in bed, haven't we? And it's been lovely. But you know, in March, when we, is it March when the clocks go back? Forward, sorry. There's a rhyme about that, isn't there? You know, back for fall and forward for spring. Yeah? But when we're grumpy, let us remember, you know? Let us make an effort to be of the agape love. Yeah? Let us just pray. Let us just close in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the great love shown to us in Jesus. Thank you for sending your Son to die for us. A true act of unconditional love that we did not deserve. We are humbled and grateful that you, the Creator of the universe, would seek a relationship with us. As believers, we ask that you would help each of us who has already accepted this love to live in our daily lives. Teach us to love others with the same patience, kindness and grace that you have shown to us. May your love fill us, transform us and overflow into our relationship, so that others may see your goodness and can know of you. Help us forgive, to serve and to give just as you have loved us. And for those who are not believers, who are yet seeking and yet to believe, who are here today or listening online, who may not yet know you personally, we pray that they would feel your love calling to them right now. Lord, reveal yourself to them and let them know how much you love by you. Help them see that you, Jesus, gave his life for them and that you desire to know them personally. May they find peace, purpose and new life in you as they surrender to your love. Lord, may your love be a foundation of our lives and our hope for the future. We pray, we thank you, in the name of Jesus, amen, amen. Thank you, Chan. Chan is going to lead us in the last song.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you. Jump together and we'll sing.
Oh,
each go our separate ways this week, that we would just spend time in your presence, and that we would just live out your agape love, Lord, that is not by our might, Lord, but it's through your Spirit.
Yes.
And I just pray, Father, that you will be with each and every one of us this week, and that we would just take the time to spend time in your presence, that we would speak your word, that we would be shining lights to those around us. I thank you, Father, in your name.